just about sun up and way past the sun going down. So we're glad you're here and hope you're well rested. We're going to hear a good lecture this hour, we know, from a beloved brother and trusted friend. And before I introduce our speaker, I'm going to ask Kevin Beard to lead us in prayer and Jonathan Beard, his son, to direct us in song. Kevin Beard is married to Brother Sane's niece, and Jonathan is the oldest son of Kevin and Jan, their oldest child, and Jonathan also is a member of the Forest Hill Church. He leads singing for us quite frequently and recently got married. We're just very, very proud of Jonathan and all of his ability. All right, Jonathan, come and lead us in song, and then Kevin, lead us in prayer.
Let's sing number 111.
Let's sing the first, second, and fourth verses. Come we that love the Lord, and let our joys be known. Join in a song with sweet accord. Join in a song with sweet accord. And love.
God in prayer, I also want to mention something to you that it is request, and I know you'll honor this request. Brother Aaron Dodson, one of our graduates who is here today with his family, gave me this information just a moment ago. I want you to remember in prayer a 10-year-old boy, Jamin Emil, and he lives in the Denver, Colorado area. This young man is... Well acquainted with Aaron's sister, and his parents are members of the church. Presently, Jamin is in Denver Children's Hospital. It was just discovered a few days ago that he has a brain tumor, and he's going to be undergoing surgery in just a little while. And so I'm going to ask Kevin to remember Jamin and this family in prayer, and I would plead with you as you pray throughout the day, please remember this young man and remember the doctors and this family during this very difficult time. Kevin, would you lead us?
Our holy and righteous Father in heaven, we're so thankful to have the opportunity today to be here, to be in your presence as your children, to enjoy the wonderful fellowship we have in Jesus Christ. We're thankful for the Bible that guides us, for the way that you have provided it for us and protected it down through the years that we might always know your will. We pray for strength and for encouragement that we might face the challenges of life faithfully, that we might overcome our temptations, that we might grow ever stronger in the faith, that we might have a good impact on the world around us, that we might lead as many as we can to salvation through Christ. We're especially mindful of Jamin this morning as he is facing a serious surgery. We pray that you would watch over him and watch over the doctors who are performing the surgery today. We pray for success in that surgery. We pray for healing for his body in accordance with your will. Also, Father, be with his family and friends who must be concerned and worried about his condition. We pray for comfort for them. We thank you for being the God of all comfort and grace, that in times like this we can plead with you for what we need, knowing that you will always do what's best for us. Bless us as we learn from the lesson that Brother Paul has prepared for us today. We're thankful for the work that he's done, not only for this particular hour, but throughout the years of his life of service. And we're thankful for the impact for the cause of Christ that he's had. Bless him as he continues his work in the kingdom. Please forgive us of any sin that stands against us. May we always be stronger to overcome the temptations that we face. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Brother Paul Sane is part of a family that has positively impacted our brotherhood for several generations. I am so very thankful for Paul and his brother David. I did not know their father, but I know of him and the great work that he did as an evangelist and also as a skilled debater. You remember yesterday morning, Brother David Sane started this lectureship, as he has done for a number of years. And Brother Paul has been part of this program for consecutive years. Well, he doesn't know, and so I don't know. I remember that I started the School of Preaching about 26 years ago, and he was a very active part of this lectureship week back then, and he still is today, and we would have it no other way. Brother Paul presently is preaching for the Cedar Grove congregation in Rogersville, Alabama, and of course he and Sister LaDon still maintain their publishing business. We have found through the years that as a congregation at Forest Hill, and also with regard to the School of Preaching, we do not have a better friend than Paul Sane. He has been so committed to the work here for so many years, and we're thankful always for the great work that he does, for the encouragement he gives to whatever worthy cause one will find in the kingdom. But I also love to hear him preach, and I know you do too, and that's why you're here. He's going to come at this time and speak to us on the subject, Hear These Words, Brother Paul Sane.
What a great honor it is to be here. It always is, and truly for this, the 50th anniversary, I know that probably every speaker or most everyone will make reference to that. The history that you have is tremendous. The blessings that it is to be present at each or as many as we can of these lectures is great. I am tempted, I must admit, as I sat here a moment ago and looked out, and I could name so many of you, and I'd love to spend a great deal of time and just make reference to how much so many of us love and appreciate you and the work that you do and where you're faithfully serving God, wherever that is, and the privilege that it is to have that fellowship together. The joy of coming to a lectureship like this is even further blessed, not just to hear the lessons, in and of themselves, they're great. But to be able to see one another and to renew acquaintances and to give hugs and handshakes and, oh, just the joy of just being together as family. And such is the feeling that I have this morning. Be turning to Acts chapter 2. It is a portion of Scripture that is commonly known as the hub of the Bible. And truly, that is going to be the beginning point of our study today. The theme is preach the word, and certainly as that word began to be taught formally from the standpoint of the beginning of the church, as we read in Acts chapter 2. As we take a backward glance, no doubt we can see the preparation that had been made by our Father, the planning over centuries of time. The church was not an afterthought, as some would have us believe today. The kingdom being the plan of God, because of the rejection of Christ, the church, that is not true. That is not taught in the Scripture. but rather the church was planned by God before the beginning of the world, before creation, the redemption of mankind. And in the fullness of time, it had been unfolded. How great it is to be able to look at the Old Testament and see these great things that had prepared the way, as it were. And then, now, Pentecost. Jesus had been on earth about 30 years of time, 3 years of earthly ministry, and he had selected those 12 men. We know the story about one, but that one replaced. And now Peter, standing up with the 11, it says. Oh, but even prior to that, Jesus had told the disciples to wait in Jerusalem. The power will come from on high. In Mark chapter 9 and verse 1, earlier than that, Jesus said, there are some of you that are standing here that will not taste of death until the kingdom comes with power. The kingdom began on Pentecost. The power came just as Jesus said. The beginning of the Lord's church, of which you and I, how blessed we are to live in a time 2,000 years removed from that moment, that day, Pentecost, and yet we can be a part of that awesome kingdom, the church of our Lord, where salvation is found according to 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 10. The church that Jesus said, I will build, Matthew 16, 18. The church in which we can contact the blood by being baptized into Jesus Christ, the culmination of our faith and turning from our sins and confessing Christ. We begin our life of service as a Christian in that church. And it doesn't matter where we are. We can be in Tanzania. We can be in Memphis, Tennessee. We can be anywhere in the world. Brother Peter Chin loved to talk to him a few minutes ago, and his work overseas, you see. But wherever we are, we're a part of that family of which we can read began in Acts chapter 2. Let's read the first words. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, just as Jesus had told them to be. Verse 2, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as fire. Verse 4, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. As we continue through and see the various things that take place on that great and wonderful day, verse 14, though, we pick up where it says, but Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice. Can I take a sidebar note for a moment? This is that same Peter that said, Lord, I'll not deny you, but he did 3 times before the cock crowed. This is that same Peter that indeed said, I'll walk on water if you can walk, bid that I come. And he did, and he began to sink. He took his eyes off the Lord. But you see, the Lord had the ability to know what Peter could become. And he became that powerful proclaimer on this great and wonderful day. Peter, standing up with the 11, and he began to preach and said, ye men of Judea and all that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you and hearken to my words. Similar thoughts, is it not, to what we're going to emphasize and focus our attention on in a minute concerning hear these words. But here he's already saying, hearken, listen, give attentive ear. I've got something that is important. Peter was not on the center stage, as it were. He wasn't trying to find glory himself. It wasn't a pat on the back that he was desiring. He was a mere servant. He was a messenger. He had something to say because this is the Christ about whom I'm going to be speaking. Listen or hearken to these words. This is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel, verse 16. And it shall come to pass in the last days. He goes into some thoughts concerning that. But then notice especially, beginning in verse 22. Ye men of Israel, hear these words. No, I'm not sure that I ever have focused upon those three words, single syllable words, as much as in preparation for this lesson, and the significance of them, and the words that followed, that flowed after them, of which we'll talk in a few moments. Peter was saying, along with the other 11, here's this great throne. We don't know exactly how many was in Jerusalem at that time. Some have estimated 100,000. Some have said it's much larger than that. It matters not. It may have been 500,000 or more for all that we know for sure. But you can only imagine them standing there and saying, we have something that you need to hear. There's this message that is important. It's about Jesus. It's about the Son of God that left the glory of heaven, that came to seek and save the lost, Luke 19:10. God loved you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, John 3:16. Jesus, as Andy pointed out last hour, Jesus was willing to suffer and hang on that cross, not because the nails held Him there, but because of His love. Peter and the apostles were saying, He loved you enough to die for you. The scourging that took place prior to this time, prior to His death, some call it the intermediate death, because many did not survive. Jesus barely survived, likely. His body cut and riddled. Indeed, His body was torn to shreds. And He did that, why? Because of love. Because He cared. Because that was the only way by which salvation could be obtained by you and me, as well as all of those in Jerusalem at that time. Simon Peter and the other 11 said, hear these words. Not only listen, but there is these words designated, specified, specific, not just one of many words, not just one doctrine of many doctrines, not just one way among many ways, but rather there is that one way. These words, the words about Christ and about the doctrine by which we can be saved by our submission to that word. Jesus said in John 14 and verse 6, I am the way. In Jesus' own words in Matthew 7, 13 and 14, there's a broad way that leads to destruction. There's a narrow way that leads to eternal life. There are certain words, these words, that need to be expounded upon, that need to be developed, and a need for you to listen. He was talking to all of them to whom He was talking in Jerusalem at that time, and He said, I want you to hear these. The specified message of Christ. Oh, we can pause long enough to maybe take a backward glance to the Old Testament and hear time and time again when the messengers, Jeremiah, Isaiah, Ezekiel, Jonah, so many others who were delivering words from God, thus saith the Lord God, here's what I want you to do. If you'll turn back to me, if you'll repent, if you'll leave your sin, time and time again, the message of God has been to the people in sin, come home, or as it were, come to me, and I'll give you rest. Noah was a preacher of righteousness. During the construction of the ark, Hebrews chapter 11 tells us he preached the truth. He sought to encourage people to come to him, to come to God and to turn away from their sin. As far as we know, none, save his own family, 8 of them altogether. They were saved in that ark. The people rejected, did not care. They were enjoying their life of sin, I suppose, and did not want to leave that. These words, the words of God, over 500 times we find in the Scripture, thus saith the Lord, these are the words of the Lord. This is what God has said, countless times in which we can itemize the exact circumstances that are prevailing at that time. But this time was different. This time was so unique. The day the church began, as I referred to a moment ago, somewhat commonly known as the hub of the Bible, My father years ago had a chart in one of his books that pointed to Pentecost and pointed out all of the things, the prophecies, the explicit things of which many of the writers of the Old Testament, and how that it pointed to, it looked forward to. The church had not begun. Salvation was not available. And yet, here's Pentecost, he pointed out in the middle. And then after that, he would look back, and the things that look back, now the church in existence. That's why this time is so unique. These words. What words are we talking about, Peter and the other apostles? Read with me further, verse 22. The words that he wanted them to hear, he said, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus. No sweeter name should cause chills to be on our body when we merely hear the word Jesus. In which salvation is found, none other. Acts chapter 4, verse 12. The man that indeed loved us enough to die for us, greater love hath no man than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends. Jesus. Jesus of Nazareth. We know the story, how that he was born in Bethlehem, taken to Nazareth. The king's edict of killing all of those 2 years and younger. What good can come out of Nazareth? Remember? But now Simon Peter says, Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs. You recall, no doubt, the times in which God from heaven would say, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Here it is. Hear ye him. Simon Peter now is talking about that same one. And Simon Peter is not the one that again is seeking the glory, but rather exalting Christ. As the Apostle Paul said, I have much I could glory about, but I glory only in Christ and him crucified. I want to exalt Christ. We hide behind the cross of Christ today. It is only important because it is Jesus. A man approved of God. He sent his only Son. And you were witnesses of it, Simon Peter said, by signs and miracles and wonders. They had watched, as he said, Lazarus come forth. They had watched as the man that could not walk now was able to take up his bed and walk. They had watched as leprosy was removed from bodies. In John chapter 20 and verse 30 and 31, and many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written, why? That you might believe, and believing, you have life in his name. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God by signs and miracles and wonders. Look at the text further. Which God did by him in the midst of you. As ye yourselves also know, God in the flesh. John chapter 1, verse 1, 2, and 3. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 14, and the Word was manifest in the flesh and lived among you. It is that same one now to whom we emphasize. Simon Peter was talking about at that time. He was among you. In the midst of you, which God did by him. The plan of God, the redemption, the plan, the scheme as it's sometimes called. The eternal purpose of God, Ephesians 3, 10 and 11. In other words, God's plan, he knew his creation. He knew his created beings. He knew that they would fall. He didn't make them fall, but he knew that they would. He knew that they would need a Savior. He knew that they would need a redemptive plan, and this plan unfolded now is coming to fruition. As ye yourselves also know. They knew. Remember the centurion soldier? Truly, this was the Son of God. That was after it is finished. The words stated by the Christ on the cross, and he took his last breath and died. The soldier knew that he was deity, as ye yourselves know. No doubt the chief priests and the rulers, many of them that had stirred up the mob and the mob that had cried, "Crucify him!" No doubt they maybe knew in the back of their mind, or maybe knew full well, that he was the Savior. But you see, their jobs was being threatened. Their livelihood was about to go by the wayside. They wanted him to be gone, rid of, as ye yourselves know. Verse 23. Him, the Christ, him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God. There it is. Specified. God knew. This was the plan of God. This was the redemptive plan unfolding. Planned before the creation of the world. Now becoming a reality. Christ had come to the earth in the flesh. John 1. He now had been crucified. Raised from the dead. As God had planned. As Christ had stipulated. He delivered, and you have taken, and by wicked hands have crucified and slain. Can we even stretch our imagination to think what it was to have been in that audience, to have heard these words? To have been the guilty ones. Very likely part of the mob that had cried out, "Crucify him," to Pilate. "When I put before you Barabbas and Jesus," and even ultimately when Pilate said, "I wash my hands." And now they're being told, "By your wicked hands, you've taken him." In Gethsemane, that mob came there and with ruffian hands, no doubt. Peter came to his defense, cut off Malchus's ear. Jesus said, "That's not, no." Put his ear back on. "By wicked hands, you've taken him and you've slain him." I might even add at this point, of course, we know according to John chapter 19, any and all of the four accounts of the gospel record that we have that tell us about how he appeared before the courts of the land at that time. A recent study of mine, and maybe you've done it and it's a little bit different. Maybe you know of more than I do, but I know of at least 24 crimes that they committed, violations of the law even at that time, that night, because they were so obsessed to slay him, to kill him. They disregarded the law. They didn't care. They just wanted him gone. By wicked hands, you've taken and slain him. When those soldiers placed his body on the ground and took that mallet of an instrument and drove that crude nail into his body, when he put the 2 feet together and drove that nail through his 2 feet, when his body was raised and the flesh torn, I need to be reminded at times of that. My Lord said, "As oft as you do this on the first day of the week, do it in memory of me." But in actuality, can we grasp the pain, the anguish, and the torment that's encapsulated in this? You have taken by wicked hands and crucified him and slain him. These are the words that Peter wanted them to know. Hear these words. But oh, thanks be to God. How rejoicing we should be that it doesn't end there. That's not the end of the story, as Paul Harvey would oftentimes speak on radio. But here now in verse 24, he said,
whom God hath raised up. Whom God hath raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that it should be holden of it. For David speaketh, and he goes further concerning David's prophecy. Jesus had said to them, the third day be raised. The disciples, his own apostles, his own chosen ones, didn't understand, remember, how they would even talk about the kingdom. I want to sit on your right hand and so forth in the discussion that took place. I doubt if any of us would as well. It was so revolutionary. It was so different. It was so foreign to their thinking. And yet, now that it had happened, and Simon Peter and the other 11 is now telling them exactly as the Savior said, exactly as the plan of God was, exactly as the prophet said in times past, he had been despised and rejected. He bore our sins. He carried our iniquities. All of the things that Isaiah 53 encapsulates, as well as the idea of being raised on the third day. He's not dead. He's not in the tomb. He's alive. Those precious women that looked into that tomb that morning and saw that he was not there. He is risen. Can you imagine how they would run back and tell all the others how excited they were? They hadn't seen him yet. Fast forward even to the time when Thomas, we sometimes call him doubting. I don't like that, really. I don't believe that he was doubting. He just wanted to see the evidence. There's nothing wrong with that. Everything right with that. But once he saw the evidence of the nail prints, remember in John 20 when he said, "My Lord and my God." He's risen, whom God raised from the dead. What does that mean? What significance does that carry? As we drop on down to verse 32, again he says, "This Jesus hath God raised up, whereof we all are witnesses." Hundreds had seen the Savior alive again, knew that Jesus had been raised. Verse 33, "Therefore, being at the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, he has shed forth this, which ye now see and hear." Hear these words. What you're hearing right now is a result of what God planned, what God carried out, choreographed, and indeed did exactly as he said. Then to some degree a culmination exploding. I find it almost in my mind as a voice raised. In verse 36 when he said, "Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly." You understand it completely. You absolutely know this to be true. You understand it assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom you have crucified both Lord and Christ. By your wicked hands, your plan didn't work. Satan and his devices, his cunning craftiness, his lies, John chapter 8, it failed. God raised him from the dead. He's at the right hand of the throne of God. He reigns. And now that which he died for, purchasing with his own blood, the church, Acts chapter 20 and verse 28, is now coming into reality. Let all the house of Israel know assuredly this is true. These words. But you see, the message that was presented that day by Simon Peter and the other 11, it did not fall totally. Oh, it did fall on deaf ears some. We don't know how many thousands were not touched, cold-hearted, determined that, oh, this is not true. I don't believe that. And even if I believe it, I'm not going to change. That may have been the attitude, the reaction of many. Oh, but 3,000 approximately. According to verse 37 says, "Then they that were pricked in their heart." They cried out. Again, if you can, try to imagine with me what guilt they felt, what sorrow and agony. Have you ever been caught in doing something? I mean, the cookie, hand in the cookie jar, but much worse. And you know you did it. You know you're guilty. You know you're wrong. Here's only 0.1% of what they felt, very likely. They knew. You were witnesses, Simon Peter said. You knew that what he did was to save your souls. They were cut deeply to the heart. And they cried out, "Men and brethren, what shall we do? What possibly can we do? Our sins are so heavy." They were not told to believe. They believed. They were acknowledging or confessing the Son of God. And thus they were told that which they were lacking at that point, to repent and be baptized for the remission of your sins. Us? How can we be forgiven of killing the Son of God? There's ever been a thought that you've had of God cannot forgive me. Folks, there it is. That's proof positive. If he can forgive and did forgive and willingly and eagerly forgave those that even nailed him to the cross, watched and mocked and ridiculed him while he was there, he can forgive us. And about 3,000. Can you imagine the rejoicing of that day? Can you imagine the phenomenal events during the time that it would take to baptize about 3,000? And they're coming up out of that water. And knowing that their sins, their crimes, vicious, evil, malicious, and now been erased. God's forgiveness is so precious that he will treat us as if we have never committed those crimes, never done those wrongs. He forgives and forgets. Such is the case of what we hear in these words. Allow me momentarily to make reference to the multiple times that Jesus spoke about it's important how we hear, what we hear, who we hear. And may I even personally digress long enough to be able to say to each of us now in this, the 21st century, there are so many that are presenting a message contrary to this gospel. Paul would say in Galatians chapter 1, "I'm amazed that you're so soon removed from the gospel." That is the doctrine of Christ. There are many doctrines of men that do not have the salvation power. They sound good. They're appealing. I mean, really tickling our ears. We've got to be careful to whom we listen. We've got to be careful on whom we're feeding by reading. We've got to be careful that we stay and our feet are deeply planted in this book. It's not just Acts 2, but how many times after that in the pages that follow we can read time and time again of various ones proclaiming the truth, and some received it lovingly, humbly, others rejected it violently. Paul said, "I bear in my body, 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one." Paul suffered greatly, but he said, "I glory only in Christ and him crucified. I exalt Christ." Oh, Paul could have gloried himself. He had much of which to brag. I mean, he had the highest of all the credentials imaginable. But he said, "I consider that as worthless and vain. Christ," Paul would say in Ephesians, "Christ who is my life." How about us today? I hope that these words have melted your heart as it does mine. To hear them again and again, I need to do that. To be reminded of the depth and the riches of His grace, the breadth and the width of His love, His longing and His passion for you and for me to be with Him forever in heaven. Us, insignificant, finite, oh wretched man that we are. And for the glory of God to be extended, the blessings. Hear these words. Thank you.
Thank you, Brother Paul. Brother Paul saying, it's always a blessing to hear his words, because he always honors the Word of God. And Acts 2, which records the sermon preached on Pentecost. We appreciate you being here during this hour, and I want to mention something to you. It's very, very important. We are really hoping that everybody here in this room, and those who may be in the ladies' classes or perhaps in the display area, we want everybody to be a part of the 50th anniversary celebration dinner this evening. And it could be that you have not purchased your tickets for the dinner. You can do that here in just a moment or any time throughout the day, but the sooner the better. And you can purchase your tickets for the dinner tonight, as well as the dinner tomorrow night, which is the Alumni Friends Banquet. You can do that by going to the church office. Excuse me, going to the school office. Our church secretary will send you on the way to the school office, so I might as well go ahead and correct that now. You may find the school office by leaving the auditorium and going to the left, going through the breezeway, and then take the first door on your right. That's the school office. Purchase those tickets. The dinner for this evening, it's going to be an excellent meal, excellent program, but $8.50 for adults and $4.25 for children. Tomorrow night's dinner, the barbecue dinner, will be $7 for adults and $3.50 for children. So please keep that in mind. And be a part of these two dinners. It's going to be a great period of fellowship, as well as some enjoyable time spent hearing about the school, and likewise always rejoicing in the work of the Memphis School of Preaching. So we hope you'll be a part of that. Let's see. I'm trying to think if there's anything else. I don't think there's anything else except to say this. During the next hour, we have several different lectures that will be ongoing at the same time, so you have several options before you. In this auditorium, you'll have the opportunity to hear Brother Bob Winton preach on Elijah. We need preachers like Elijah. But we also have several classes that will be taking place in the MSOP building. Now, I'm not sure which particular program you have. There has been some scheduling conflict for the class that meets in room 405, I believe originally it was to be Brother Bobby Liddell to speak. And then I think perhaps some of you have a schedule that says Nathan Liddell. Well, we're back to Brother Bobby. And so if I understand correctly, Brother Bobby Liddell will be speaking next hour in room 405 on the subject, How Should We Preach Expositorily? And then in room 201 of the school building, we should preach love. Brother Ray Peters will be discussing that particular subject. And then room 411 of the school building, we should preach hope. Brother Joe Nichols will be preaching in that particular room during the next hour. And all of this leads up to lunch, which will be served at approximately noon. And of course, lunch will be provided for all our many guests. And so we look forward to being together at that time. Right now, you are dismissed until the top of the hour.